Hi and welcome to IT Chronicles 10 in Tech. I'm Kirstie Magowan. I'm here today at Knowledge 17 with my co-host Shane Carlson.
Hi, hello. Shane.
And we have the pleasure of chatting with Stefan Brahmer today from Sim for People.
Hi there.
Hey, Stefan. Now, do you want to just start off by telling us a little bit about what Sim for People does?
Yeah, in Sim for People, we come from the background of doing some troubleshooting around incident and problem management, and one of the key insights that we got during more than a decade of being in the field was people struggle with getting all those skills and put them into action.
Yep.
So when we started the company, we decided that having something more tangible, something about gamification, something that is appealing to people, not only the old generation but also the current generation, would be good. So we came up with this idea about troubleshooting simulations.
Yes. Simulations have been hot for a while in the market. I mean, what are you seeing people's appetite for using SIM for educational purposes in the ITSM and the ESM spaces right now?
I think the key thing is get results fast,
yeah.
Right? Learning is tough enough, and if you look at traditional learning, it's been a huge amount of theory, and then magic happens, and we expect everybody to go back into their workspace and apply what they've learned. We're going the other way. We want people to learn through simulation.
Yeah.
So we keep the theory to a minimum, put up something attractive, in our case it's Lego robots, and then we want people to experience the essential parts of troubleshooting and learn by that. And what we're seeing is, and the feedback we're getting from our clients is, this is closer to reality, and therefore it's easier for them to put it into action.
Yeah, I can't imagine why Legos are popular with geeky folks in our industry learning.
It's
strange,
amazing.
That, isn't it?
Boggles my mind.
Yeah. I had the pleasure of being able to just get a small taster of Stefan's a few weeks ago in Oslo.
Yeah.
And when I saw it on the program, it was sort of like, you had me at Lego, I'm there.
Yeah.
And that's the thing. You want people to be in a positive mood, right?
Yes.
It makes them receptive. It makes them, I want to learn as opposed to I have to learn. And what we're also seeing is that people, they're used to get everything fast and available nowadays, right?
Yeah. And you've seen, actually, there's a lot of studies out there that talk about, you know, children and adults learn better when they're in a playful mode. You know, when they feel like they can interact with the learning devices, they tend to retain more. They tend to understand how to apply that in the real world more. What are you and your customers seeing kind of as tangible benefits of you know, the SIM approach to training for especially a lot of the technical stuff in ITSM?
Well, first of all, we're aiming for covering a lot of people at a minimum amount of time. So you get like a critical mass in your organization in order to see immediate effects. And that could be better documentation, the overall approach to troubleshooting, or also collaboration.
Yeah.
The challenge is always to get them started. Once they get excited and they have some successes, everything rolls beautifully.
Yes.
But it's that shortness of time and get people to want to learn. So what we're seeing in our clients, you start with a pilot, and then you get more requests from people because they all talk to each other.
Absolutely.
And that's fantastic because passion is something that we're really keen on, and we want to make sure that people want to learn.
Yeah, contagious enthusiasm is the best marketing ever.
for sure.
So, Stefan, you come from a Buitrago background, haven't you?
Correct.
So are you using the Buitrago methodologies as part of the program you're doing? Is that involved in the review?
Yeah. What we're looking at our stuff, and we look at it as a foundation.
Yes.
And whenever people need more sophisticated implementations or they want to run a real project around it, that's when we work with Buitrago and we collaborate with them and make sure that they also come in and do the what I call higher education around troubleshooting. Right.
That's perfect. So you know, if you were to give us one fun fact about what people learn in your sims or kind of one of the big takeaways, what would that be?
Well, the thing is, because they combine the experience of doing something with a scenario, the scenario-based training enables them to come back with war stories and remember that was when the robot did this and this. And it just makes it easier for them to transfer it back into real life, and that's great to see.
Perfect.
No, certainly, the very small taster, I want to do it again. I want to get into one of the a fuller workshop, because just that little taster I had certainly showed you that it could be a really, interactive, interesting learning experience, actually making that robot do what it's supposed to do.
And also what we're seeing is because we're zero PowerPoint, right? So no PowerPoints at all. And that resonates well with the audience because many people come from that PowerPoint only kind of foundation.
Yeah, that alone should make people love you.
Yeah. Well, hopefully.
So, you know, how big of a classroom do you guys typically have with the sim learning with the robots?
Well, the ideal size is like 15, 16, because you want groups that not only interact. So we have, for example, we have exercises where you swap them in between an exercise and they need to continue with something someone else has started with. Mm. And you need that dynamic.
Because that never happens in the real world.
No,
not at all. So group dynamics is an important thing. Mm. So better having a bigger group. Mm. I mean, if you have multiple instructors, you can do, we've done up to 60.
Wow.
Mm. But then that's like three instructors in the room to give them the right coaching.
Yeah, that was just from that short taster I had, that was probably my biggest takeaway, was how poor we actually are at transferring information from one group to another. It just doesn't happen very well.
Yeah, and it's because we all have our own kind of intuitive approach of doing it, and that might or might not resonate with the rest of the group. If you work together on a daily basis, then you work out how you do it.
Yeah.
But if you actually get thrown into a major incident or any of these multi-sources scenarios, you don't know the people you're working with. So are they at their best performance? Are they having a bad day? Yeah. How do you know?
So you mentioned a multi-provider environment. So how often are you seeing your clients bring in not only their employees, but the employees of the providers, you know, these cross-functional teams, and trying to get them to work together through your simulations?
I think it depends on the culture of the company. If they're used to work in a collaborative way with a multi-provider environment, then typically on the second kind of workshop, they've seen what it is, they see the value, and they bring them
everybody in the room.
There's also companies where they absolutely don't want to share anything with their colleagues or providers or something. So it really depends, but it's definitely doable, and I see a lot of benefits.
Yeah, I can see it being tremendously valuable. Yeah. I mean, because one of the biggest problems people talk about in a multi-provider environment is getting the work passed from one group to the other. One group will do exceptionally well with their piece of it, but when they pass that off to the next group, that handoff is very unclear. And I can see a huge benefit of applying the sim immersive approach to problem solving in that group of people and forcing them to work together outside of their normal work environment to learn how to work better together to pass those things off.
Right. Mm-hmm. So not only to get to know each other, because sometimes these people know each other from the phone, but they've never seen or never worked directly on a specific case with each other. And it's also all these escalation points, I call it the white space, where information comes from A to B and B gets it and is totally frustrated about it, but doesn't bother to give feedback also to A, because they don't have a common way of talking to each other.
And they don't have the context of what happened before the point at which it got handed to them. All they have is the information that's presented to them. Yeah. So
I see this become more and more important. If we think about Internet of Things, we think about Industry 4.0, we think about, you name it. Yeah. I mean, everything that's cloud-based, that's distributed, we're going to see more complexity.
Yeah. Have you guys done any studies on how much more effective the sim-based immersive training is over traditional classroom or academic approach?
Well, there's a couple of pieces out there. Because we're very specifically targeting to incident problem management, what we can do, we can compare the traditional approach and how long it takes for people to take up that right behavior compared to what we're doing. And even in the session, we're using dashboards that will show to people how they progress through the different exercises.
So you can actually measure their progress throughout the simulation.
But on group level. So you don't want to have the individual like I'm kind of measured here. But you can see from exercise to exercise, let's say on a two-day course, how they progress and how they get faster on the symptom detection and how they spend more time in actually finding the courses. Mm-hmm. So that's quite obvious.
Perfect. That's great. That's great.
Oh, great. Well, thanks a lot for spending some time with us today, Stefan.
Thank you for having me.
And I really look forward to seeing how your business grows.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm eager to go get my hands on some robots now.
Yeah.
So. All right.
You need to go and do one of these.
And see, this is the effect. You bring something in like robots, and it has an immediate positive spin to it. And that's the way it should be. Well, thanks again for making the time.
Thank you.
My pleasure.